Welcome back. We are now in segment 7.3. In the earlier segment, in segment 7.2, we have discussed that the term loan appraisal can be broken down into four major sub-segments, right? We have something called the managerial appraisal, then we have the technical appraisal, we have the industry appraisal, and finally we have the financial appraisal. So these two put together, these four put together will be what is known as the term loan appraisal, right? So even though these terms may sound intimidating, right, these are actually these are actually plain common sense. Okay, imagine you are just walking on a road and you suddenly met your colleague, right? This is a colleague who is working in your bank, right? He's your colleague whom you are very familiar with, and he says he forgot his purse and he needs 500 urgently. See, you'll be having absolutely no hesitation in lending this money if you have that 500 with you right now, and you have no other urgent need for yourself right now. You'll be having absolutely no hesitation in lending that 500 to you, because unknowingly you are applying some credit principles here which are very basic to lending. One, you know the borrower very well, right? He's very familiar with you, right? He's of impeccable integrity. He no way he's going to default on that 500. And one, he's an employee in your own bank, right? You can always track this customer, you can always tag this person, and you know the amount is so small, his salary is some 30,000, so there's no way he's going to default on this 500, right? And you also know that should something terribly happen that he cannot repay you, then he'll arrange this amount from some of his relatives, or ultimately he's going to be paying you rather than being called a cheater or a liar. No, he's of such high integrity. And actually, don't think of this consciously, but then each and every point is a relevant point in the decision you have taken, right? Now imagine a second scenario where a clerk in your office has asked you 10,000, right? Imagine another case where your neighbor who's working in your factory has asked for 50,000. His monthly salary is just 8,000, but 50,000 is he's asked for 50,000. Maybe another person who's an unemployed person who's actually referred to you by some other friend of yours. You don't know this person directly. Now he's asking you 1 lakh. Another case where total stranger walks up and asks you to lend 2 lakhs. So as you can see, these are different scenarios. They are differing not just in the amount here, but also in the risk factor here. So let us analyze each of the situations to get a better idea of to how risky this lending is to this each of these 5 categories, and then we will link up to the actual process of term loan appraisal to companies. Okay. So what we'll do is we'll take various parameters. Forget for the moment that we are dealing with companies and term loan appraisal. Let us forget this point, right? Where we are just dealing with some individuals, and what we are going to do is we are going to take one point at a time, right? We are going to take one point at a time and compare these 5 scenarios, okay? And then ultimately we'll link this to the term loan appraisal. So if I ask you, what is the familiarity level with these 5 cases? So in the case of 500, which you have given to a colleague, this person you are very familiar, right? In fact, it's not just a colleague, but also a family friend. Maybe your families visit each other's house for dinner on a weekly basis. You're very, very familiar with this person. Maybe on a scale of 10, you will give this person a score of 10. You're very familiar with him. Then there is this clerk. He's also familiar with you, right? He's working in your office. You may not know him very well on personal level, as you know this colleague, but then he's reasonably familiar to you. Maybe you will give a score of 8 here, right? Then there is this neighbor, right? This neighbor who is working as a welder in some factory. He's also very familiar to you, right? Maybe you know more about him personally than your office clerk, because you interact with him on a daily basis. Maybe you can give a 9 here. There is this person referred to you by some other friend. You don't know him directly. You're not familiar with him, right? Maybe you'll give a 5 here. And there is this stranger. You're not at all familiar. Maybe 0, right? Just keep this in mind. What we're going to do is we are going to take various parameters where you're going to see where these 5 different cases fall into. Okay, so what about credibility? If I were to ask you to rank these various cases on the aspect of credibility, so this colleague of yours is of spotless character. His integrity is impeccable. He has very high moral standards, so you can rate him maybe 10, right? This clerk, well, he's a decent person, and there is actually you don't have any reasons to doubt his credibility. Though you don't know him as familiarly as this colleague, you know he's of good integrity. Maybe you can give a 9 here. And this welder, this neighbor, right? There were instances where you have seen some lenders have come to his house and demanded a repayment, right? Maybe he has not paid up the dues to them. You've seen this a couple of times. But you also know that somehow he has repaid them, maybe by borrowing his friends, or somehow he has repaid them. He's going to ultimately repay. So you know he's of very good credibility. Okay, so maybe you will also give a 9 to him. Then there is a person referred to him. Someone told you that this young man has actually a history of borrowing and not repaying. So his credibility is doubtful. So now you are very concerned about this particular person. Then there is this stranger. He's a total stranger, but he says he's running his own business, and he says he'll pay 20% of your loan. He'll pay a rate of interest of 20% for your loan and repay it within 1 year. So he's prophesizing something. But then you are not sure about the credibility unless you inquire about this person. Unless you start inquiring about this person, you are not sure about this credibility. You are uncertain. So maybe we'll give a 0 here. Okay, don't worry what we are doing here, right? We'll ultimately link all those this to the term loan appraisal. For the moment, just forget about the term loan appraisal and just focus on what we are doing, okay? Next, for example, if I were to speak of the parameter of salary, this colleague of yours is earning a very healthy salary. Per month, he's earning some 30,000. So his salary is very good. Then this clerk is someone who's earning only 10,000. He's not earning as much as your colleague, but 10,000 is all right, okay? Then there is this welder. Now, welder, he's getting some assured income of 10,000, like this clerk, but then he has some loan installments to pay on priority, right? He has some urgent commitments. Every month he has some installments to be met. So even though his salary is 10,000, maybe on hand, maybe he's available some 6,000 or 7,000 only. Okay. Then this unemployed person, no income. He's unemployed, right? He'll borrow money from you. He'll start a small business, and he's saying he'll repay you out of those the profits from those business. Actually, has got no income. Right, and the other person is doing some business, right? So it's not a regular assured income, but he's doing some business and he seems to be earning some good profits. Again, this is the comfort you get is varying in respect of the salary. Here you're not at all comfortable, maybe here you're very comfortable, okay? And the other cases are varying. Maybe you can give a 3 here, maybe you can give a 8 here, maybe you can give a 6 here, right? So it's also varying here. Then what about the financial strength? So your colleague is not actually a very rich man, but compared to the amount, just the 500 he borrowed, his financial strength is more than capable to repay you this loan, right? But the clerk who has borrowed 10,000 from you, he's of average financial strength, but the money borrowed is actually equivalent to his 1 month salary, isn't it? His monthly salary is 10,000 and he's borrowed 10,000. In a way, his this amount he has borrowed is equivalent to 1 month's salary. This is not really huge in a way, of course, because as we'll see, companies borrow a lot of amount, but then it is not as small as this 500, right? And this borrower, this neighbor who has borrowed some 50,000 from you, his monthly salary is 10,000 and he's borrowed 50,000. So after meeting his installments, maybe his on hand is getting only some 6,000. So actually the loan which he has borrowed is some 8 or 9 times to his salary, what he's getting ultimately, right? So this is a huge amount for him, right? And this unemployed person actually has no financial strength. No, he is yet to start the business. And this stranger who said he's doing some business seems to be some of decent financial strength. But then we need to check with others because he's a total stranger to us. Okay. What about the repayment ability of these various cases? So in the first case, your colleague, the repayment ability is excellent, right? Because that amount is so small. In fact, the same day he might come to your house and repay it, give it back to you. No. So the repayment ability here is excellent. In the next case, it's not difficult. Right, he should be paying it to you. The clerk has borrowed 10,000 from you. His salary is 10,000. Probably he'll be paying it to you in maybe 2-3 months. In fact, he might be paying it in the very same month which is borrowed, or at the most in 2-3 months, because it's not a huge amount. The neighbor who has borrowed 50,000 to you, payment ability might be a bit difficult because you already discussed that he has some other commitments. He might take some time to repay you, maybe 1 year. No, the repayment ability is actually a bit constrained here compared to the previous two cases. This friend, this unemployed person, right? The amount is high, first of all, 1 lakh. The repayment ability, when you speak of this 1 lakh, we don't know what business he is going to take, what is his capability in this field, whether he can successfully run this business. So it's difficult to judge the repayment ability. We actually may be doubtful, or definitely we are not positive. I mean, we don't know anything about this person, nor the business which is going to run, right? So repayment ability, we cannot comment very accurately on this. And this stranger, he said he's already running a business. We don't know the performance of the firm, but the amount is very huge, right? So unless we know the profit which is running, what is the business he's into, we cannot judge the repayment ability. So in these two cases, actually the repayment ability is difficult to judge. It is excellent in the first case anyway. And here it is a bit for the neighbor. In the case of the neighbor, it is a bit difficult, right? What about assets, personal property in the name of these five individuals? Do they have some land or flats, gold in their name? Let us see. Colleague is an average salaried employee, doesn't have any assets. Let us assume. Then this clerk is also an average salary employee, he doesn't also have any assets. Then this neighbor, same case, not having any. But this person, right, the unemployed person which we spoke of till now, we discussed many negative points of this person, right? We spoke so many negatives about this person. He's unemployed, we don't know what business he is into, what business is going to take. Repayment ability is doubtful, but then he's got a house in his father's name, right? He's got a house, and he says he's willing to, in the worst case where he's unable to repay you, he'll sell this house and repay you. So there is some mitigating factor here, right? There is some mitigating factor in the sense that this there are many negatives for this proposal, but then compared to the other proposals who have no assets in the name, this person seems to have some asset backing. You can call this security. This security is in a way provide some comfort to you that in case this 1 lakh is not paid to you, whether he will ultimately sell this house is a different issue, but then there is some tangible security that we can fall back upon. And this stranger which we met, the 2 lakhs which are given, he also has some properties in his name. So in these two cases, actually there is some comfort in the sense that there are some tangible securities to fall back upon. Let us see, what is this? Are you going to earn any income from extending this loan? The colleague will not charge any interest, right? This is a small amount for a small period, and he's very close to you, not going to charge any interest. Maybe same is the case with the other two cases, your clerk and neighbor, you're not going to charge any interest. But this two person to whom you're given this huge amount, 1 lakh, and there's a lot of risk involved because he's an unemployed person and you don't know him personally, right? So definitely you'll charge some interest. Maybe you'll get some interest income out of this. You also stand to gain if this business clicks and right, if he does well. Not only you get the 1 lakh back, you will also get some interest. Same is the case with this stranger, right? You will charge some interest. So in these three cases, you're not going to get any income, but here in the last two cases, you're going to get some income. What about technical knowledge in this field? Well, this colleague is a banker with good experience, but this is not a factor. It's not at all a factor when you lend this 500 to you. I mean, this is a small amount, so that's not a major factor. Similarly, the clerk is a person with a decent knowledge of his day-to-day work, but again, that is not a major factor why you lent this 10,000 to him. You lend him because basically he's familiar to you, right? And his repayment ability is okay. That's why you lend to him. Now, this neighbor who's working as a welder, he is currently working in a private company, and he may lose his job any day because he's working in a private company. But his skill at welding is very good, so it's unlikely that he will lose his job due to incompetence. But even if he does lose the job, he can easily find another job in another company. That is the confidence you have. You have confidence in his technical in his skills, right? Technical skills. This person, the stranger, the unemployed person to whom you have given 1 lakh, you're not sure what this young man is actually capable of, right? You're not sure. You're doubtful. And the stranger also, you're not sure about his competence, but you made some inquiries and people told you that he's actually running the firm with some very good competence, right? He is running the firm with good competence. Then when you analyze the comparison with peers, right? So the colleague compared to other bank colleagues is on par. I mean, there's nothing special about him, but he's not worse off, right? He's on the same platform as his peers. Same is the case with the clerk. But this neighbor, if you compare with him with other daily wage workers, he's actually below par. He seems to be not doing that well. And this unemployed person, compared to other young people, he's very much below par. Okay. And then if stranger you compare to other firms, he's actually below par. So in these three cases, what we are seeing is when you compare with other people of the same age or the same skill sets, right? They are actually tend to be doing. They're not doing that well compared to the other people having the same skill sets. Then if you were to see, should the situation arise, will he default on the loan or will he repay it by selling his personal assets, right? What is colleague going to do? Well, the amount is so small that there should not arise a case of default, but should the case arise, he will somehow arrange the money and pay you off, right? The clerk will also definitely do that. The buyer probably he will, because we discussed that sometime in the past there were some instances where people have demanded payment. He come to the house and make some angry scenes, demanding repayment. So maybe he has defaulted, but he has paid them ultimately. So maybe probably he will repay you also, even though he is unable to repay out of his salary, but somehow he'll arrange. We are not doubting his integrity. Probably he will definitely sell maybe his gold and ultimately repay you, right? This person unemployed fund is doubtful. You don't know. You actually think he might default, but you're not actually very convinced about this young man. Doubtful, right? And then the stranger also, since you have done inquiries, the inquiry said he is running the business competently, yes, but in the past he has defaulted to some lenders. So that is what your inquiries have revealed. So if you see whether this income source is long term, income source is definitely long term because he has a service left of more than 25 years. Same is the case with clerk, he has more than 10 years service left. The neighbor, it is a private job, so we cannot be sure that he'll be having this job forever, but we told that he's got some very good welding skills. So even though he loses his job, he can definitely get a job elsewhere. So the income source may not be assured, but definitely it's not that it's going to dry up in the near future because he has got age on his side, right? Definitely he has got he's also got the necessary skills. So the income source may not be long term, but it's not uncertain. He's definitely going to get some job. Now this young man, unemployed person, is doubtful whether the business will even click or not. We don't know. Forget about the income being long term or income source being long term or short term. But there's no income source here. First of all, this person will take these funds and invest in some business and start doing some business. Whether the business clicks or not is to be waited and seen. Right? We're not sure about it. Stranger is actually already into the business. Right? This particular business in which this stranger is running is actually a business that is prone to risks. Okay. So we cannot say whether he's going to make profit every time. Though he has been making profits in the past, we cannot be sure whether he's going to do that in the future because this particular business, which is maybe he's a flat builder engaged in real estate. So maybe we're not sure whether he's going to make profits every time. And if I were to ask you, after meeting all expenses from income, so what is the comfort level to repay your loan? So in the first case, the comfort level is exceptionally high. See, the salary is 30,000. And maybe his personal expenses after meeting his rent and various other expenses are just 20,000. So he's got an amount left of 10,000 and your loan is just 500. So you're covering some 20 times, you know, that leftover amount after meeting all his expenses. After meeting all his expenses, he's still got some 10,000 left. And your loan amount is so small, so it's covering some 20 times. So it's an absolute comfort to you as a lender. Now the clerk, we discussed that. The clerk's salary is 10,000. You're given 10,000, right? Maybe his expenses is 8,000 and the leftover amount is only 2,000. Now, if you were to compare the coverage you get from the loan or 10,000 you get, this is only 0.2 times. It's not even one time, right? It is only 0.2 times. So you are having a bit of low comfort here compared to the first case. In the case of the neighbor, this should actually read 10,000, right? The salary is 10,000, not 8,000. So, and this should read 5,000. The leftover amount is 500. So out of his salary of 10,000, his expenses are say 9,500. So this leftover amount of only 500. So if you compare this 500 with the loan of 50,000, you're given, you're having a comfort of only 0.01 times. That leftover amount is providing a coverage of only 0.01 times your the loan amount. So this is a very low amount, exceptionally, it's a very low amount of comfort to you. This person, the young man to whom you have lent 1 lakh, he feels that business will generate a profit of 5,000. This is his estimate. Per month, he's going to make a profit of 5,000, though it's not certain. But then that is what his assumption is. So this will be covering our loan amount by 0.05 times. And the stranger says he's earning a monthly profit of 50,000. So he's providing a coverage of 0.25 times to the loan of 2 lakhs we have lent. So across the various cases, you're seeing the various amount of comfort we have in lending to these various cases. In here, we have a exceptionally high level of comfort. The loan amount is so small and the earnings are so high that basically, there is no case of default. It's very unlikely that this person is going to default. So we have a very high comfort level. That comfort level is going to come down. In this case, it is very low, right? In this case, also there is more uncertainty involved here. But even then, the comfort level is a bit low here. Okay. So we have analyzed these five cases from various angles. So if you have made a decision whether to lend or not to individuals as above, now if you in the past. If you encountered similar situations as this when you lent to a colleague or to a neighbor, and if I made a decision, then actually you should not be finding any difficulty in doing credit appraisal because even when you want to decide whether to lend to a company or not, more or less these are the factors which you consider. The reason why we discussed these various factors was that even if you were to lend a company, these are exactly the same factors. Maybe some may be more, some may be less. The technical and the financial, the balance sheet part we will see later. But more or less, these are the factors which go into when you lend to a particular company. The additional factors, of course, we'll consider shortly. But then these are the basic factors which you consider when lending to a company. So let us do a mapping. Okay, let us do a mapping. This is the individual case which we discussed so far for the five individuals we discussed. Let us relate this to the company. You see, when we discussed about something called familiarity in the case of individual. In the case of company, also we'll be asking about these questions about familiarity. So since how many years the company is banking with us? So that is the first question we see when you get a proposal. Is this a past customer? Is this an existing customer? So how many years is the company is banking with us? Is it for the past 3 years or 5 years or 10 years? Some are some very long-standing customers, 20, 30 years. So the larger the dealings the company has with us, the more comfortable we are. And then when familiarity, we're also asking the question, are the promoters existing customers of the bank? Are there any group firms whom the bank has extended credit facilities? So not only this company, this company might be a new borrower to us, but are there any group companies who have been dealing with us? So when you're dealing with familiarity, we're saying whether these promoters are in some way associated with the bank. So if they are associated with us, if they have some past dealings with us, our comfort level will be going up. So this is the same case which we also looked in case of individuals. So here also, in the case of companies, these are the questions you ask to gauge the familiarity we have with the company. Then we discuss something about credibility. So here also we'll be asking some questions related to credibility for the company. So what are we know this is a past company. This is a company that is having past dealings with us. So are the past dealings and operations satisfactory? Right? And is the repayment record satisfactory? Now what about the dealings of the company? Is the company transparent in its dealings with our bank? Were there any instances when the company misled the bank either by giving false information or it took advantage of the bank? These are the instances which reveal the credibility of the borrower. If the company actually has a dealings of more than 3 years, 3 to 5 years, you'll be actually in a very good position to judge whether the borrower is of a good credibility, is credible or not. It's very easy to judge, provided of course you are working in this department for the past 3 to 5 years. Continuity is something which you don't usually see in banking, because if there are a lot of transfers, but there will be some continuity. So if you are new to this department, there will be some other senior who is working in this department for the past 3 years. So there will be some level of continuity. So you can judge the credibility of a borrower. So reason, if a borrower is be dealing with us for the past 3 to 5 years, it is a good enough period to judge the credibility of a borrower. So you'll be asking questions, you'll be seeing the operations, the past operations, right? How is the company operating with the bank? What is the repayment record? Are there any overdues? And if there are instances of overdues, whether the company has promptly repaid, even if there is difficulty, whether the company has ultimately repaid. So what is the dealing? How are they dealing with us? Are they dealing in a transparent manner, right? Has the company misled the bank in any case, on any equation. So these are the questions we'll be asking to judge the credibility of the company. Okay, then the salary. In the case of individuals, we talk of salary. Here we'll be speaking what is known as the profit, right? Though income, you might say income is more the correct word, right? Salary, but then I'll shortly tell you why profit is important to us than salary. Okay, then we spoke of financial strength of the individual. So in case of companies, we'll be also discussing about financial strength. We'll be analyzing the profit and loss account, the balance sheet, and see what is the financial strength of the company. We'll be using some various ratios and metrics to measure the financial soundness of the company. Especially we are interested in the top line and the bottom line, that is the turnover and the profitability. But also there'll be some other ratios, key ratios that we'll be analyzing. Okay, so in the case of individuals, we discuss about the repayment ability. So here also, in the case of companies, we'll be discussing whether the earnings, whether the profit of the company is satisfactory for the loan to be repaid, right? So this we'll be discussing as we'll see. We'll calculate something called DSCR to see the repayment ability. In the case of individuals, we ask, are they having any assets in their name, right? So similar in the case of company, we're asking, is there any collateral security available in case the loan goes bad? Should the case arise where the loan goes bad and the loan cannot be repaid, do we have some collateral security to fall back upon? So if the collateral security is high, definitely the banker's comfort will be higher. Okay, then we spoke of what is the income to the from the individual's point of view. What is the income? Are you receiving any interest, any income, right, from the borrowing? So here also the bank will be asking, what is the income we are going to receive? What is the rate of interest that bank is going to receive to this account? Okay, then we spoke of the expertise of the individual in that field, right? We are similarly going to ask, what is the expertise of the company in this particular field? What is the prior experience of the promoters in this field, right? What is the, has the, are the promoters capable of running this unit? Has the management demonstrated competence in running this unit? So these are the questions we'll be asking in case of a company. So in the case of individual, we compare them with peers, right? In the case of companies also, we'll be doing the same. We'll be doing some intercompany analysis and comparing with other companies to see how is the this particular company do, comparing with respect to income, profitability and various other parameters. So in the case of individuals, we ask, should the situation arise, will he default or will he go, he's going to repay by selling some assets? So here also we're going to ask the companies. So in the case of companies also, we are worried about it. Is this company likely to be a willful defaulter? I mean, should the case arise where this loan cannot be repaid out of the profit of the, maybe the unit is not generating good enough profits. So will the promoters seek a way to escape and somehow avoid the loan, or are they of good integrity? Somehow they will sell even their personal properties and repay the bank loan. Are they of such a good integrity, or ultimately they are going to turn as willful defaulters? Then we spoke of it in the case of individuals, is the income source long term? Is this person has a long service left over? Similarly, in the case of companies, we're going to ask, is the project viable? The company is going to earn profits, okay, but is it going to earn profits for 10 years or 15 years till the loan is going to be repaid? What is the long-term viability of this project? Okay. Then in the case of individuals, we ask, after meeting all expenses from income, what is the comfort level to repay the loan? So here also we'll be discussing calculating what is known as a DSCR. So actually, if you see, we have discussed some various points in the case of individuals. In the case of individuals, we have discussed some various points. We have taken five different examples. We have taken the example of a colleague, a clerk who is also a colleague but is earning lesser salary than the your colleague, right? Then we discussed a neighbor who is working as a welder in a small private company. We took the example of a young man who is unemployed but he's got age on his side. Then we discussed a person who is totally stranger to you, okay, but he's doing some seems to be doing some good business. So we seen some various parameters when you are about to lend to these individuals. You said, what are the factors you consider when you lend to individuals? We said these are all the factors you consider, right? These are all the factors you consider when you provide, when you're planning to lend to individuals. All these are relevant factors. Similarly, even when you are going to lend to a company, these are exactly the same factors. These are exactly the same factors you consider when you plan to lend to a company. Exactly. I mean, there's a one-to-one mapping. Each and every point which you discuss has a one-to-one mapping in the case of companies. Of course, there will be some additional factors. I'm not saying these are the only factors. There will be some additional factors which we are going to see later. But by and large, there's not much difference between lending to an individual and lending to a company. The questions we ask in respect of a company while sanctioning a loan are not at all very different. They're not very different from what you would ask of an individual. So, but somehow we seem to be more comfortable when we appraise an individual compared to a company. There seems to be a level of comfort when you are lending to an individual. You can make a decision. Okay, this person is working in a private company. His salary is so and so, 8,000. He's now asking a loan of 20,000. Maybe the risk is a bit more, but okay, he's of a good credibility. He's our neighbor. And immediately you make a decision. You are very comfortable when appraising an individual compared to a company. When it comes to appraising a company, you feel a sense of intimidation. There are so many factors to consider, but not at all. As you have seen, the factors by and large are same when you're dealing with an individual or a company. And have you seen that we have covered all the four aspects of appraisal so far? We discussed that there's something called managerial appraisal, there's a technical appraisal, there's a industry appraisal, and there's a financial appraisal. Actually, we have covered all these four appraisals in this headings, in these points we have covered so far. See here, when we're speaking of familiarity, what we're actually seeing is the manager appraisal, even credibility. Familiarity, credibility, we're actually assessing the manager appraisal. The salary, financial strength, and repayment ability is the financial appraisal. Right? Assets is actually a manager appraisal, because in case the loan goes bad, whether the promoters are going to repay the loan. So this is a manager appraisal. And then the income to you from the loan is a financial appraisal. The technical knowledge and the skill, this will be a technical appraisal. Comparison with peers, intergroup comparison will be a industry appraisal. And what is this, should the situation really default on the loan? This we are speaking about the credibility, right? The integrity of the borrower. So this is a manager appraisal. Is the income source long term? Financial appraisal. After meeting all expenses, what is the comfort level? Financial appraisal. So if you know these points, you have done the major part of the term loan appraisal. Whenever you take up a term loan proposal, if you consider these factors, you have done more than enough. All the appraisals you are covering. And then since you are dealing with a company, maybe there will be some additional factors which you can take up later. But these are the basic points to start with, okay? So don't feel intimidated by any term loan appraisal. It is plain common sense that's going to guide you in most occasions or most instances. So what's the bottom line of this segment? Literally, what is the bottom line? Right? This is the bottom line, right? So the bottom line is, don't be scared of project appraisals. In the end, it all boils down to plain common sense. Okay. So these factors, if you are good enough in appraising this while lending to an individual, you are more than competent to appraise a project. Because project appraisal, as I said, it ultimately is about is to a very large extent plain common sense. Okay, so with this we'll conclude the segment. In the next segment, that is 7.4, we'll be having a brief overview of the project appraisal. Right, we'll not be going into details, we'll just provide an overview, and then in the subsequent segments we'll drill down deep into the individual aspects. Okay, so see you in segment 7.4.